a little bit late, but coming at you with some Bob Ross content. So to outline what I'll be doing tonight, I'll be taking you through two separate Bob Ross paintings. As you can see, I'll be streaming Bob Ross down here on the left, so you can watch and paint along if you wish. And yeah, that's pretty much it. I'll try and keep an eye on chat as we go along. And if you do any paintings, if you're part of the Warwick Tabletop Discord, make sure to post them over there. And I might showcase a couple of them at the end, depending on how long we've run over time and got started a bit late. Okay, so I think we just delve straight into it. Let me just save this canvas first, because Photoshop has issues with crashing, and if I don't save it, it won't autosave, etc., etc. Let's just call it Bob Ross 1. Right, let's get into it. Also, let me know if like the audio levels are a bit funky. okay, cool. Oh wow, dulcet tones right in my ear holes. I'm gonna turn that down a little bit. Okay.
Start out and run all the colors across the screen that you need to paint along with us here. And while they're doing that, let me show you what I've got done up here. I have my standard old 18 by 24 inch pre-stretched double prime canvases we always use. And I found some masking tape here in the studio, so I just sort of put that around like so and took a can of spray paint and painted the edges. I thought we'd just do something easy and it's a lot of fun. Something a little different.
Hint, I won't be doing this just because, you know, a little bit of faff. Alright. Time for the sky.
Quite strong, just a little. Just tap the bristles right in there. Okay. Let's go up in here and let's just build us a happy little sky today.
So didn't set up my brushes before.
I hope it is wherever you're at. So I thought we'd do a painting that just reflects that. There. Just using little crisscross strokes. Let's just drop in a quick little sky. And I've chosen phthalo blue because it's very similar to the color that we sprayed the canvas with. And you can do this in any color. This just happens to be what we had here, so that's what we used. There. Okay. And that easy, we've got a nice little sky. And just blend it till it's nice and soft. And it's continually mixing with the liquid white, which is on the canvas. And that way it gets softer and softer toward the horizon. And that's exactly what we're looking for today.
Okay. I'll have to do some blending work in a sec, because you know, digital ain't quite the same.
Flavor the blue.
Alright, Bob's a bit ahead of me already. Okay, so we got a little bit of assumed water just coming up down here.
And then very lightly and very gently, we'll just go across the entire water area here.
Oh, that's not.
And that sort of blends it together, makes it nice and soft. Now, the most fun part of all this is washing the brush.
this is one thing you miss with digital art. Sorry, Bob, just going to move you to the left a little bit.
All right, maybe in our world today, maybe we have a little cloud. Maybe we use a fan brush today to make a little cloud. Just load both sides full of titanium white. And let's go right up in here and decide where a little cloud lives. Maybe we have a little cloud in our world that just sort of hangs around right here.
Okay, can get into it.
I'm using just the corner of the brush, making tight little circles. That's all we're doing. Just very tight little circles. There. Okay, now we'll get a 2-inch brush. Be sure it's dry. And very gently, using just the corner again. Just
ooh.
Blend it.
Go on.
Just blend the base of the
come on, fetch up.
And then very gently fluff it up a little bit.
I'll be fluffing up my cloud in a sec. God, Bob, you're so fast. Stop it. Stop being so good.
Several layers of clouds floating around up here. So we'll just have another one right here. Right there.
Do you reckon they, like, edit this? You know, like, to just kind of make him a little bit faster? Or do you reckon this is, like, the actual speed he paints at? Because, you know, if it is the actual speed, that's, like, absolutely incredible.
Thin and diluted, and it's not, you're not going to be able to blend it like this. But you can put as many layers of these in as you want, just one after the other. See there?
I adore painting clouds, to be honest. Like, it's one of my absolute favorite things about doing landscapes, is like the sky and the clouds and all of that business. It's just so, you don't have to be precise, you just kind of, you know, get in there. You know, do a little bit of,
go into some black. We'll use a little of the blue, we'll use a little Prussian blue, lizard crimson.
Let's bring that down a little bit.
Just mix it up, pull it out as flat as you can get it, and cut off a little roll of paint. It lives right out there on the edge of your knife. Maybe our big mountain lives. Where does it live?
Oh, we're doing a mountain now. Alright, this is always the exciting bit. Oh god. Right in the middle. Okay, let's get a nice dark colour in there. New layer, just in case we fuck up. Alright. Going down.
Right there. Just sort of let him float around in that direction. Just sort of make a decision and put it wherever you think it should be. And that's really all you have to do.
Alright, bigger brush.
Now then, with a clean, dry, 2-inch brush, we want to grab this and pull it. That does two things. It removes excess paint, so the next layer sticks easier.
Oh wow, he's gonna.
It makes your mountain get lighter and lighter toward the base, and that's exactly what we're looking for. There we go. And just blend it until it just sort of floats up there in the sky.
There. Right. I'm sad it's obscuring my, like, my nice.
That easy, better.
My nice that clouds that I drew earlier.
We'll use a little titanium white today. What the heck? Take a little white. Also, pull it out as flat as you can get it and go down, cut across and get our little roll of paint. It's very important. Maybe we'll start right here. And you can play little games and have fun with this. No pressure. Absolutely no pressure with a knife. You're just barely touching it. And we'll take a little touch of, we'll use a little pale blue, maybe a little touch of black in it. And we'll make it some nice shadow color. Something like so. Once again, our little roll of paint. We'll go right up here and decide shadows are. There's one. Here comes one. Goes distinctly through that one. There. And you put the shadows just wherever you think the light would strike.
Okay. Right, sorry, Bob. I'm just going to have to pause you real quick because... can I pause you? Yeah, okay. Just because... You are way too fast. Right, so we've got a little bit, we need to do a little bit of light on this side of the mountain, I think it was. So just come down. Let's remove the pressure on that and just kind of... come down there with my little bit of light. And then we do a little bit of shadow on the other side. Okay.
You should have missed. I'm going to tap that. Very gently. And sometimes it's fun when you're doing mountains to play games with which one's in front and which one's in back. But make up little stories in your mind. Maybe this mountain lives right here and it comes, look at that, see? Distinctly in front.
Okay.
There we go. Also, sometimes it's very nice to have a little cloud that floats along and goes right in between those. So I want to add at least a little touch of liquid white to the paint right on the fan brush. The liquid white's to make it a little thinner, because a thin paint will stick right up here without messing everything up. And we can put a happy little cloud that lives right in here between these two. Clean, dry brush, very gently.
Okay.
Doing a little bit.
Just on here.
And that'll give us the impression that there's a little cloud up there. We can bring this right on distinctly through.
And to assume it was Finbar who put it in chat to call him Bobbert. Please. Oh, okay, we're doing the mountain over here now.
Just float right.
Oh, wow.
Absolutely no pressure. Let's go with this big one here.
And this one, oh my goodness. You're really getting that white.
It has to be very firm. Very firm. So you won't get this breaking. And this breaking is what makes your mountain so pretty.
Yeah. See, that's harder to do in digital. At least I don't think I have the right brushes for that, unfortunately. Not right now.
On the other side, we're going to have shadows coming right down through here.
All right, shadows again. Let's make that a bit more gray this time.
Make those little noises or it didn't work right. Can you work back and forth? Maybe we'll put some nice bumps and ridges out here on this mountain. There they go.
A little bump.
I'll sort of let your imagination be the guide here. There. Back to our shadow color, because every time you have a little projection out here, you need a shadow behind it.
Yes. Words of wisdom.
Shadow.
Every projection needs a shadow.
Dark base color a little bit. Just let a little of that flow right down. Play games with light and dark, and that's what'll make your mountain so fantastic. Wherever you think these little things should be. A bit of our shadow color here and there, right in there.
Just gonna add a little touch of blue in here. You know.
We're gonna mess around and have us a mountain here. Let's just tap. We want to create the illusion of mist at the base of this.
It's a decent mountain. I'm not gonna complain about this mountain.
And all this does is remove the tap marks and blends everything together.
Still a little blending.
Over here, we'll follow these angles. It's most important though that you follow these angles. There. Right in here. And sometimes, it's a lot of fun just to play some games. Watch here. Maybe in our world, there's another little mountain that lives right there.
Ooh, surprise mountain. Little surprise extra mountain.
The illusion of distance in your painting when you have layer after layer of these things. Scrape off the excess. We'll go back to our titanium white. Put a little highlight right here on this one, too. Just let him go. No pressure. I can't say that enough times, and I say it over and over because this is one of the major problem areas that I hear in letters and stuff. Hard time making the paint break. And the reason normally is it's either one of two things, too much pressure or the paint is too thin. Mix up a little more shadow color here. And we can put some shadow right in there. See how you can move things around? Unlimited power on this canvas.
Unlimited power.
Now, once again, let's grab that, tap a little bit, create that misty illusion.
Gotta. You're so fast.
Just
we're almost there.
So,
And we could take a little bit of that shadow color. Do a little bit more smudging over here. You know. Just using the corner of the brush.
There's a little bit here. But all these different planes create the illusion of distance.
And we need this little kind of ridge.
Get a little crazy and watch. See how to push that foothill back and bring that mountain forward? Isn't that fantastic? Behind the mountain. That easy though. You can change your mind, push mountains around, and move rivers, whatever you want to do. Whatever you want to do. Okay. Tell you what. Wipe off the old knife. Let's mix up a little bit of lavender color here. And for that, we'll use a little phthalo blue and alizarin crimson. Proportionately, much, much more crimson than blue. We'll make a nice lavender. And if you want to see what color your lavender is, take a little white and mix some color with it. Because you can't tell. That just looks black. So put a little color there. And that's just right. Let me clean off my knife. We'll grab us a fan brush. I'll tell you what. Let's go right into a little of that. I'll pick up some white. There. Just make sort of a nice lavender color. Maybe even a little more of the crimson. Oh, I like it better. But just mix this till it's the right flavor.
I love till it's the right flavor. Yeah, it's amazing description. Honestly. Alright, we're doing trees now. Yeah. Alright. New layer. Let's get some of these kind of lavender gray trees in here.
Takes very little.
Thin brush. Darker than I've got it as well.
Maybe a few of these trees back here. Maybe they're a little bigger. You can make out detail on them. There. We'll give them a little print.
Come on, Photoshop. Doesn't like it when I switch the brush a bit and kind
of. And I want to create the illusion of mist at the base. And just by tapping to the top corner, we can do that. I want it to be very soft and hazy and very misty back there. I'll just let that sort of go on off into nothing. But look at all the different layers in here. Okay, good. Then gently upward. And just blend it out down on the bottom. There.
Oh, good.
All right, time to have some fun. Let's mix this up some color here. We'll just take a bunch of dark colors. We'll use there's black, there's Prussian blue, some brown, some crimson. Maybe we'll take that phthalo green that was left and throw it in there too. There we go. Maybe a little sap green. I want it to have a little greenish tone to it. But you might as well mix up a pretty good pile of paint. Pretty good pile of paint. Shoot, I just use that same old fan brush. It's working pretty good there. We'll load it full of color, with a lot of paint on both sides. Now we have to make some big decisions in our world. Maybe there's a nice evergreen tree. There's right there. I'm going to dip the brush into at least a little bit of thinner, so it'll stick easier.
Because we're going. All right, we're doing a big tree. Want to go with the
paint to be a little thinner, so it'll stick. And I'm pushing upward with
a
brush.
Perhaps a darkish bluish green.
To make a little evergreen.
Okay, where do we want it? Here.
Let's have another little evergreen. Just push gently upward with the brush. All you have to do. There. And you make a decision how many trees live in your world. Maybe there's one there. I don't know. One there. This is an excellent way to practice your little trees, though, so. Make a few of them. What the heck? You put one way over here. Make a few of them. There he goes. And we'll just, while we get this old fan brush running here, we'll just push in a little bit of dark color. Like so. There. Tell you what, let's grab the 2-inch brush. I want some reflections under that. So all you have to do, since the canvas is wet with a liquid white. Let's grab that and pull it straight down. Pull it down. Isn't that sneaky? Then go across. And we have instant reflections. Maybe there's a little projection. Comes right out here. Something like so. In your world, you make the decisions where you want all these little things to live. Just put them in. And all we're doing is laying down a dark base color so we can come back and put a few highlights on there.
Need some more trees. I'm lacking on my trees.
Each time you do a little peninsula of land, you need a little reflection under it, or when your painting's done, it'll look just like it's floating. Tell you what, while we get the old brush running, let's go on the other side and give it a tree.
Alright, Bob, gonna have to pause you. I'm sorry, you're way too fast. Right, so we need some... couple more little trees in here. Just in this kind of area. Get those in. Some more tree business. Then we need to think about these reflections in a sec. So let's pull this down a little bit. And then we wanna just gonna do it straight across to begin with to get that line. And then we go down. Not super pronounced. Actually need a bit more watercolor just down here, so I'm just gonna paint that in underneath just so it's a bit darker. And there'll be bigger reflections under these bigger trees. Just smooth that down. Okay, and then we want this peninsula area, which I will do here. With also a little extra tree, I feel like. Just gonna do one like coming up the edge here, just to get a little bit of depth in there. All right. Okay, let's go back to Bob.
Maybe this tree lives up there.
Okay, we're doing a big one.
We don't know.
Okay.
Push upward though. Think about little individual limbs that live in this big tree. Do something like so. Just let your imagination go a little bit. Look at your painting. Everybody's painting is going to look a little different. And look at it. You may have the things that are better, but you don't want to mess up. Don't change it just because I did. Go gently across. Now that.
Got a friend tree.
Take a little white, a little dark sienna, mix it together. And let's put the indication here and there, but little tree trunk in some of these things. Just touch. Won't be much showing you back here. Maybe there's one right here. We don't want him left out. And an old big tree. It's a big one. You can see more of it. There. I'm going to grab another fan brush. I have several of each brush going, so I don't spend all my time just washing brushes. We'll take a little yellow and I'll take a little of that color made the tree out of. Mix it together. It has blue in it. Automatically, it's going to turn a beautiful green whatever flavor you want. Let's go back in here. Light's coming from the right.
Okay, I need to do a little blotch.
So let's begin putting in little things like this. Just a few little highlights.
Just a little.
Then we'll put a lot of highlights in these trees. Tell you what, you know, I travel all over the country and I meet a lot of exciting people. And as you know, I'm absolutely crazy about little creatures and stuff. And recently I had the opportunity to meet a fantastic lady by the name of Carmen Shaw, and she lives in Orlando. And we filmed a little bit of footage with her, and I'd like to share some of that with you.
This is Carmen,
one of her little pets. This is a little.
We're getting animal footage in this poor Bronx video.
And it's just very young. And Carmen takes care of animals that have been orphaned or they've been injured, and she patches them up, and she devotes her whole life to taking care of these little creatures. And these kind of people are absolutely wonderful, and they're necessary if we're going to preserve some of these creatures. I want you to watch as he feeds this little possum. He's a hungry little dude. There. You see, I just get to go and enjoy him. She has to do the taking care of it, though. Look at there. Think that rascal's not hungry? He's something else. But I got to spend several hours with Carmen, and she shared with me quite a few animals that she has over there. She has everything from cranes to hawks and owls and just a multitude of animals that have been injured or hurt. And she does all of this on her own. I think it's fantastic. And amongst all her little creatures, she has deer and fox and raccoons and etc. And she has a little fox named Major, which is one of the cutest little creatures God's ever made. And Major has been hurt, and somebody even cut his tail off. But she allowed me to go in the cage with him and show a little bit of that here in just a second. All we're doing here is just dropping some highlights here. There.
Okay. He's talking about foxes and doing all the painting, and I'm like,
a little fox, as I say, his name is Major, and he's absolutely precious. And he thinks he's a puppy. That son of a gun is just about as tame as he can be. I got up all my nerve and got in the cage with him there. And as you can see, we made friends very quickly, and we had a very good time together. While you're watching that, I'm just going to put in a little water line right here. This little devil was fascinated with my hair. He thought it was steel wool. Maybe it was time to clean the dishes or something. I don't know. But he was fascinated with my hair. He tried to eat my hair off. The only thing I'm doing here while you're watching that is just putting in a few little water lines here and there.
Just need the painting, Bob. I love the fox, but I need the painting.
Isn't this little fox just beautiful? Just fell in love with him. Let's say his name is Major. There. Okay. I spent about an hour in the cage with this rascal, and we just had a heck of a time together. Oh, while you were watching that, I just put in a few little water lines using a liquid white on the knife. Now then, let's have some fun. Shoot. And put out a bunch of liquid white here. Wipe my hand off there. And with that, I'm going to put a little dark sienna into it. Let's see here. Hit my hand with the paint. We'll take a little bit of the Van Dyke Brown dark sienna, and I'm going to go right through this stem color that I've made. And maybe up here, there's just a few little stones that live in here. And all you do is take the side of this filbert brush and just do like so. Wherever you want these little stones to live, just like that. See, and you can put as few or as many in here as you want.
Whoa.
And it's sort of neat when you want a little stone here and there. There's one even back there. Now then, let's take here a little bit of the liquid white on the knife and just sort of go around these stones. That helps set them right down in the water. We can take a fan brush, a little liquid white on it. least little touch.
I'll just do a little couple because again, he's way ahead of me.
And just begin putting in all kinds of little water things that live around these stones. There. Just let it work right on back. Like so. Hope you enjoy seeing these little animals. They are so precious, and I love to show them to you and share them with you. Because these little critters are my friends. I spend a lot of time with them. And I enjoy meeting people like Carmen and the bird lady that we're bringing here in Muncie and everything. These are special people to me. Okay, tell you what. Let's come right up here. Let me pull this tape off and let's see what we've got today.
Okay. It's kind of a painting. It's not the cleanest Bob Ross one I've done. That's for sure. But
it almost looks like the picture is matted. And it's a very nice little effect. Let's take a little red liner brush. And let's sign this one right about here. I think we'll call it finished. I hope you try this little painting. It's very nice and you'll enjoy it. From all of us here, I'd like to wish you happy painting, and God bless, my friend.
Thank you, Bob, for another wonderful episode. Right, I'll let the credits run for a sec while I just do a little bit of cleanup just on some of this. That's like, oh my god, I wasn't even born then. Okay. So that's our first Bob Ross. So I'm gonna save this. And then we're gonna go into a second video. Gonna see if we can do this one hopefully a little bit quicker. So let me just open up this second one that I want to do. Okay, gonna go right into it. I think if I recall rightly, this is another landscape one. So let's create. Canvas size, put the width up a bit. Okay, Bob, gonna make you a bit smaller.
Back. Certainly glad you could join us today. I thought today maybe we'd just do a beautiful little winter scene. So let's start out and have run all the colors across the screen that you need to paint.
Okay, so this one's called, I think, A Portrait of Winter.
18 to 24 pre-stretched double prime canvas, but you use whatever size is convenient. And I've covered the entire canvas with just a very thin, even coat of liquid white. So the canvas is wet. It allows us to blend color right up here.
Just doing a couple of arm stretches. Not that you can see me, but, you know, sitting over cramped at your desk is like a shrimp. It's bad for you, so remember to do a little bit of stretching every little while.
Sure is a nice even distribution of color all the way through the bristles.
Alright, we're going back to blue.
Now then, let's start up in here and just make little X's, little crisscross strokes. And we'll go all the way across the top. The color is continually mixing with the liquid white that's on the canvas. And that's why it blends beautifully like this. If you had a dry canvas, as I like to say, you'd be in agony city about now. Because it just doesn't blend like this. There. That's the beauty of the liquid white. It just allows us to blend color on the canvas. All right. See, something like so. A little more color on the old brush, and we'll come right in here and do something like so. That's all. Just little cross strokes, crisscross strokes, or cross-criss, whichever. Now, sometimes I like to make the edge of paintings a little darker so that it intentionally will bring the eye into the center of the canvas. So for that, I'm going to add a little bit of Prussian blue. Blue is much darker and much stronger. And that I'm going to apply just to the corners. And we'll go over on this side. Put a little bit right there. can just blend the entire sky. I left that blank intentionally because I think I'll have a big cloud that flips right around there. While we have that color on the old brush, let's add a little more of the phthalo blue. And, same way, just tapping. And I want a little water in this painting. Shoot, you know me. I would paint water in just about everything that I do. I love to paint water, and in this technique, it's one of the easiest things imaginable. There, pull from the outside in, and I want to leave a little area of light right in there. So just pull from the outside in and leave that there. That's all you have to do. And then very lightly, just go across the entire canvas.
God, that's a noise. That's like reverse ASMR going on right there.
It'll look like light shimmering across the water when we're all done.
Oh, I keep hitting the edge of the canvas. Oh, so then, sec.
Brush the old brush. Take off excess. And just beat the devil out of it. We can just stay with that same old brush and go right into a little bit of the... A little bit of the titanium white. I'm just going to bounce the corner right into a little bit of white there. Okay, let's go up here. Now then, I just want to make some little fluffy clouds. And today I'm just going to do that by just tapping. Just tapping. It's all you have to do. In this series, I've done a lot of clouds like this because they're the simplest, easiest kind of clouds that I've ever found. There.
All right.
In the past series, we've showed many, many other ways of making clouds. So you find the one that works the best for you, and that's the one that you want. I want to add the least little touch of alizarin crimson. I want to put a little pinkish flavor down toward the base of this cloud.
Ooh, pink flavor.
Not much. Just a little. There. Just to give it a hint of pink. There. Like a little sunshine is dancing through there. There we go. Now very lightly, just barely touching the canvas on. Just barely blend that a little bit, just to bring everything together. But those tap marks up here make very soft little tops to your clouds. Now with a clean brush, I'm just going to blend it a little. Not much. Not much. You don't have to do a lot of blending with this, because there's not a great deal of paint on the canvas. But isn't that a nice, easy way of making a big old strong cloud? Tell you what, let's give him a friend. You know me, huh? I think everybody should have a friend, so we'll do the same
thing. Yeah.
And maybe, yep, right there. We'll just tap in another happy little cloud. Or big cloud in this case. Maybe he lives.
Ooh, big one.
Right out to here. It's up to you. Up to you. Wherever you want. Something like that. There. Once again, a little touch of the crimson, just to flavor it a little, right down here at the base. I'll get my clean, dry 2-inch brush, and we can just blend it and fluff it. There. Something as easy as that. And the more you blend it, of course, the more subdued it will become. And you can literally blend it away. And that's the way you correct it. If you ever make a cloud that you don't like, you just blend it away, paint you another one. We don't make mistakes. We just have happy accidents.
Yeah, you said it.
And I mean by that is that after a while you become so confident with the method that you don't worry. Anything that happens, you can use it in your painting to your advantage. And that happens very, very quickly. Now then, today I'm going to make a little mountain. In past series, we've made a lot of mountains, but I still get requests every day for mountains. That seems to be the favorite thing.
Everyone loves a good mountain.
Black. A little bit of the Prussian blue and some alizarin crimson all mixed together. And it still looks blue. Pull it out as flat as you can get it. Cut across, and we have our little roll of paint lives right out of the edge of the knife. And let's go right up in here. You have to make your first major decision. Where does your mountain live? In our world, it lives right there. Right there. Now you have to make a lot of decisions. How many little peaks and bumps do you have on your mountain? And this is a very individual thing. You decide. You decide.
Time to make a big mountain decision.
And it could be a mountain that you've seen before, or it could be a mountain that you've seen only in your imagination. It doesn't matter. But it's your mountain. That's the only thing that counts. That it's your mountain, and it makes makes you happy when you paint it. There. Put another one right there. What the heck? This is a good day to have a little exercise.
Language, Bob. Language. No hex allowed here.
And of course, we're not interested in that happy book. But if you're out selling paintings, very few things sell better than mountains. Everybody likes to have a nice mountain painting hanging in their home. And guess what kind I have in my home? I have a house full of mountains. I love them. Probably comes from living in Alaska so long. There we go. Take a 2-inch brush and just pull that paint out. Just pull it like that. Very gently. And you can just move the paint on this wet canvas. Blend it. And if you can see the entire mountain, it's always more distinct at the top than it is at the bottom. And this is mixing with the liquid white, and automatically that'll happen. Automatically. You don't even have to worry about it. Don't even have to think about it. Just blend it. See, already I see like a nice valley right in there. When these things happen, treat them as little gifts, little painting gifts. Use them. I'm blending upward now to bring a little of that liquid white up in here. I want to lighten this even more. So it looks just like a little valley. There we go. Okay. Yeah. We're going to have a little winter scene, so let's put some snow in there. We'll take titanium white, pull it out as flat as we can get it. Really mashed out. Cut across, get our little roll of paint. Now then, no pressure. Take the point of the knife, put it right at the point of the mountain. See, just put it right up here at the point, and then let it flow. But no pressure. I can't say that enough times. Mountains are one of the most fantastic things to paint. Just love them, and it's so easy like this. Son Steve, if there's anything that he really excels at in painting, probably it's mountains.
Oh yeah, Bob's son Steve that I learned about like the other day. I had no idea.
He'll get the big head and want to raise. He works for us and just travels around and teaches. And actually, I guess he's self-employed because I don't pay very well. There. Okay. Now then, these back here, I want to make them look like they're very far away, so I'm just going to grab the base of them and gently blend a little bit. And that's about all I'm going to do to them. I want them to be far away. Back here in that valley. There. Since we have a little valley there. Now, I'm going to take some white, a little bit of titanium white, some of the phthalo blue, we'll mix it together like it's about so. Pulling out very flat, once again, our little roll of paint. Normally, every time I load the knife, I load it with that little roll of paint. There. And now, just let that sort of drip right down like that. There we go. And I want it to just gradually disappear back into this little valley here. Very quiet little thing. A little bit right in here. Good one here. That little shadow, though, creates the illusion of a peak or something protruding out. I'm going to create a mist right here. So I'm just taking the brush and tapping, following those angles, most important, then lift upward. Now, sometimes it's fun to play little games. Take a little more white and watch here.
Doing another little game.
See there? We have another hole protruding through here, another peak. That easy. But it needs a shadow. It needs its own little shadow or it won't play with you. Just go away and leave you. All alone. Good clean dry brush. And we can tap that a little bit. There. And right here. There we go. Now, sometimes fun to play little games. Maybe you want to create even more depth and distance in your painting. So let's take a little more of that dark color, same little mountain color would come right about here. Maybe, yep. We have another little mountain that lives there. Maybe there's another peak.
New mountain.
Whatever you want, wherever you think it should be. But you need that dark color in there just so it'll show, just so it'll stand out. It separates. It's your good friend. Take care of it. Our 2-inch brush, grab it. Once again, just give it a little pull. Something like that. There you go. And we're going to do exactly the same thing again. Just take our little roll of paint right on here on the edge of the knife and put a little bit of snow right on this mountain. This painting will give you a lot of practice with a knife and making beautiful mountains. And don't be afraid if one didn't come out just right to evaluate it, scrape it off, and do it again. Because that's the way we learn, is by doing things over and over, over and over. And it doesn't mean that you've done bad, it means you're normal. Because I'll tell you, there's not anybody who's painted that hadn't scraped it off and redone it. Many, many times. Not if they're a good painter. You can bet they have scraped and repainted. It's part of the price that you pay to learn to paint. That's all.
Yeah, for me, that's mashing Control Z many, many times. Deleting whole layers an hour's worth of work that I decide I don't like after doing it.
Shadow right in there, something like that. There. See that? Isn't that unbelievable? In just a couple of minutes, you can make a mountain like that. And you really can. Maybe the first time you try this, it's going to take you more than a couple of minutes. But the more you practice, the faster you'll become. Initially, don't worry about speed. Don't even think about speed.
Bob, when I'm streaming here and
you won't even realize it's happening.
God, was streaming even a thing in 1990?
Took you
God
maybe
knows.
4 or 5 hours to do a painting, that you're doing that same painting in half the time, and then it's half again, and then pretty soon you could knock these little rascals out just like we do here, and there is no editing here. What you see is actually what happens.
Confirmed. No editing. Interesting to know.
Same color and adding a little white to it just to make a lighter blue and put some little trees way back in the distance. And for that, let's use our little fan brush. We just load a little color on it. Something like that. I'm just going to tap downward. Just want to make the indication of some little trees that live way back.
Okay. I'm going into tree land in a sec.
Far, far away. We're not looking for detail. Detail comes in the foreground. There. Okay. Back here, just indications once again. Just indications. Too much detail will ruin the illusion of distance in your painting. So don't try to put a relief on these little trees that are living way back here. You don't see them in real life. Let's take our old 2-inch brush. I want to grab the bottom of this. Watch here. Decide where land and water meet. Pull straight down. Zoop, zoop, zoop. Like that. Go across. And that quick, we have instant reflections. Instant reflections. And take a little bit of liquid white. Pull it out very flat. Cut across. And we'll go right up in here. And I'm just going to cut in a little water line using the knife. Straight on, pushing very firmly. Very firmly. There. Something about like that. The water line just really sort of splits up these two dark colors and gives the indication where the shoreline is. Good. Now, same old color we was using. I'm going to add a little bit more of the blue to it, just to darken it a little. Just to darken it up. I need a little more black too. What the heck? Have it all. Something like that. Okay, let me clean off the old knife. I just wipe the knife on a paper towel. Or a little soft rag, whatever you have. Gonna load the old fan brush back up. And don't be shy here. Put a bunch of color in that brush. Shoot, get brave. Get brave. Maybe in our world there's a big foothill that lives. Make a decision, Bobby. There you go, right there. See, all you gotta do is just decide. Because this is your world. You have total and complete power over this world. You can do anything. Anything that you believe you can do. All you have to do, visualize it in your mind. See it over and over. There. And what you can visualize and believe in, believe that you can do, you can do. I know you can.
Because I see pictures
every day from fantastic people all over the country, and they are creating some of the most beautiful paintings. And that truly is the joy of painting. It really and truly is. Put a little detail maybe on that one. Maybe he's the big boss tree right there.
Goals being there. The big boss tree.
I'm just tapping firmly, put a little color on the canvas, wherever. Trees grow in every size and shape and description, just like people. Just like people. They're different. Some are big, some are small, some are tall, some are small, whatever. That's what makes them so fantastic. It's what makes people so fantastic. If they were all alike, wouldn't it be dull?
Well, Brossart has to fit in wisdom about people and trees. Simultaneously.
I'm just really filling that in. You could do this with a 2-inch brush if you wanted to. It'd probably be a little easier and faster. But since I have this going, what the heck? Doesn't matter. Now I'm going to lift gently upward. But all those little splotches now look like hundreds, maybe thousands, little trees. Or however many you want in your world. You make up your mind how many it looks like. Part of it I'm going to pull straight down. Create a reflection under there, like so, go across. When I was a traditional painter, reflections used to absolutely drive me up the wall. Shoot, I can remember painting something and then turning the canvas upside down and it and make it shimmer. Reflections probably are the easiest, simplest, quickest thing that we do in this technique. A little liquid white here, give the indication of a little water line right underneath that. Pushing very firmly, very firmly. If you ever have one here you don't like, take your 2-inch brush, grab it, pull it right into the reflections, and it just goes away. Just goes away. That easy. That easy. All right, let's put some evergreens in here. Usually when you have this kind of scenery, there's some beautiful little evergreens living around there. Clean me off a spot to work. I want them to be very dark. So start with black, Prussian blue, some crimson. Well, we'll throw a little blue in there too. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. There we go. Little knife put on the palette there. Sometimes I get in too big a hurry. All right, load the brush full of color again. Get a lot of paint. A lot of paint. Let's go right up in here and decide. Our tree.
Right, foreground trees.
That's all it takes to make a decision. Just decide. Use the corner of the brush. As you work down the tree, push harder and harder, forcing the bristles to bend downward. Most importantly, bend downward. And underneath the limbs, that'll make all the little hang-me-down things that live under evergreen limbs. I don't know exactly what you call them. I've always called them hang-me-downs. But I bet you know what I'm talking about. Maybe it's not a proper word, but you understand.
Hey, Don's work.
Here's one. He's got a little bend in him. See? Like that. There. Okay. We'll give him a friend that lives right there. There we are. Just back and forth. Makes a neat little sound on the canvas, too. I like that. I like the way it sounds. It's really fantastic to me. When we finish this series, I think There'll be 312 Joy of Pain shows.
Holy crap.
It's unreal.
That's so many.
It breaks every record in television history for an art show. 312 shows. And I'm getting a lot of letters now from people that say we haven't seen all the shows. And so I think what I'm going to do, I've been talking a little bit here, maybe what I'm going to do is pick out some shows that are my favorite. The paintings are my favorite paintings. And I think we're going to put them together in a series we're going to call The Best of the Joy of Painting. And let you see what my favorites are. And this way people will have the opportunity to see how the Joy of Painting has progressed from the very beginning, because we'll just intermix these shows. I think you'll really enjoy it. But if you'd like to see it, let us know. Even better yet, let the station where you're watching this know. And we'll make it available to them very soon. We'll call it The Best of the Joy Painting. How's that? I think it'll be fun. I'd like to see some of the old shows myself.
I don't know whether that exists.
Yeah. Take a little white, a little crimson, a little blue, like a little lavendery color, but sort of pinkish. There. Put the indication here and there. Just a little tree trunk. Wherever you want. There, that's enough. Then we'll take a little liquid white, a little titanium white. We'll grab the least little touch of the phthalo blue and put it in there. Something like so. Let's go up in here. And let's just put the indication of a little highlight, a little snow maybe laying out here on some of these. There. Darker, darker, darker. As you work down. Darker, darker. Just a few here and there. Be careful, don't cover up all the dark, because evergreens normally are a little darker than most trees, so you don't want to kill all that beautiful dark color. I'm going to take some white, a little bit of the phthalo blue on the 1-inch brush, and maybe in our world there lives some happy little bushes. So right now all I'm doing is putting in a little base color for the little bushes, wherever we think they should be. Maybe, yeah, why not come right down like that? Get a clean 1-inch brush and dip it into liquid white. Liquid white. I'm gonna clean off a little spot here to work with. There we go. Liquid white. And I'm gonna pull the brush in one direction only, right through the titanium white. I'm gonna load a lot of color into the, a lot of paint into the bristles. There. Now with that, we're gonna come back and just begin highlighting this.
Goodness.
Snow-covered bushes that live in
oh wow! Okay, not sure how I reproduce that, to be honest.
One bush at a time. One little bush at a time. Okay, maybe there's one.
Theoretically, I should go and get a different brush, but
here and there, down here. And you don't have to make all of them white. Leave some of them the dark blue because they'll be in shadow. They'll be back in the shadows. The little bunny rabbit hides. There we go. We can take a little titanium white now. And let's just quickly put the indication here of a little snow right at the base of these. Something like that. But pay attention to angles when you do this. Don't just throw this on at random. And worse yet, don't pull it straight down. If you do, it'll look like huge cliffs.
You can hear me dabbing furiously at this.
Then we just fill that in wherever you think the little snow area should be. This is a very cold winter scene. It's all done in blues. Yeah, I think you want to put your coat on. And I think for that, you've about to have a finished painting. Scratch in a few sticks and twigs, call that one done. Hope you've enjoyed it. And from all of us here, I'd like to wish you happy painting.
Good.
God bless, my friend.
Good. Oh, a little bit at the end there. these bushes. Oh my goodness. Okay, okay. So that's that. I'm gonna probably do a bit of a speedy exit here because we started a bit late and we were meant to be having like a final little interlude just to see things out for today. So thank you all for joining me, and please share your paintings if you have done them. If someone in the next interlude wants to show off paintings, then they can go ahead. But yeah, thank you so much for joining me for this joy painting. I hope you enjoyed it. And I will say goodnight now. So yeah, night night. And I hope you join us for day two of the stream. I am absolutely amazed that we hit over £1,000. Absolutely incredible. So thank you all for donating and coming along. So yeah, have a good night. See you all later.